wonderful. Good morning to all the great audience we have here at TEDx Marwadi in Rajkot. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity. Today, being here is a pleasure, as well as I feel so warm to come in front of you to present my perspectives of what we have done and what I think is justice. Okay, something which must be very inquisitive, where you must all seen a tied black band with a justice thing. So here I've just tried to get a picture of one of my FPS shops, the fair price shops. You know, what we expect, you know, what society expects is that both should be at the same level. We get equal ration of what is on the measures on the right side. And that is exactly what the government is also trying to do. And we, as implementing and the executive, we try to do that. So we try to bring both on the same level. And that is what justice means, right? So justice has not only to be done, it has to be appeared to have been done. So that's where I would begin my my introductory talk today. Okay. When TEDx and Marwadi invited me, this is what I was thinking. I think you can all read it. It's very easy to talk about justice, but it's very hard to deliver justice. I hope all of you agree with this, right? See, talking about justice, we can go on and give lectures, but to get it down on the ground and deliver justice to the poor is the ultimate goal of which why we all are here, right? Okay, let's talk about justice. Justice has about four types, in which the first one is a procedural, where if there's a procedure established and something goes wrong and we feel that we have not followed the proper procedure, then we try to bring procedural justice and back to ground zero. Second one, if you see, it is called retributive. So somebody feels that, you know, or if the authorities feel that something has gone wrong and that justice has not been done, we punish and we get them back to retributive. The third is restorative. Again, this kind of justice where you feel that some justice has been denied or delayed, we try to restore justice to those people who have been denied or delayed justice. And the fourth type is the distributive justice. What is distributive justice? That is the job of the executive. Get it from the government or get it from the public resources and give it to everybody on a fair basis, right? So all these four also comes as a part of the executive, of a job of a collector or a district magistrate. And now, what are the means to achieve justice? As you all know, justice could be got through peace, and justice could also be got through other means, apart from peace. So that's where a lot of people come into activism, and we call people rights-based activism, where you can see that people fight for their rights through activism and writing letters and asking for, this is the law, what have you done, and all those kind of things. Second thing is a social revolution, where an entire community or an entire generation or an entire bunch of people get together and try to bring about a change in the society. That is where the social revolution comes into play. And through that also, a lot of people have achieved justice. And that's what we have seen in entire history. And third thing is what we do on a daily basis to establish a welfare state. And that is the whole objective of the Union of India. Now, the Constitution of India also provides various options, and various provisions have been enshrined in the Constitution. That is like Article 38, Article 41, where it says the state has to secure a social order for the promotion of the welfare of the state. And that's what we exactly trying to do each and every time, that every government schemes are made, every policy framework is made based on these kind of provisions. The directive principles of state policy say there are four things. There are four things that need to be taken care of, that you need to have an equitable distribution of resources. You need to provide equitable sources of options to people. And second thing is equality. You need to have equal distribution of resources, wherein equal things are provided right from the high class to the middle class to the lower class, wherever you take up. And third is the access to resources, where we give equal option and equal access to people who don't actually have it or who have excess of it. So we try to proportion it and bring it to a same level. And fourth thing is human rights. That is where everybody gets activated, you know, like we need to have proper basic human rights. And it is a right in itself. And the third provision is the United Nations Social Justice Guideline, which says that there's a fair and compassionate distribution of the fruits of economic growth is also a guideline, and it's a policy to take up these issues. So again, equity, access, and we need people to participate. And along with participation, it has to be provided with equal rights. Okay. I'll just go through my presentation today on one basis, like what I have been going through or what we have tried to do a little bit in Rajkot. So a wonderful opportunity of being a collector is that you can do a lot of things if you actually intend to do, apart from your routine kind of work that you keep doing. When I came to Rajkot, this was a scenario. It was almost like the post-second wave of COVID. And I'm sure the entire world has gone through this bad phase, which an unfortunate phase. This photograph you can see would be something which sends a very strong message. I was totally taken aback by the way these children were in a state of issues. When I joined, we had a lot of deaths that happened during the second wave. Post the COVID second wave, a lot of children became orphans. They lost both parents. Some lost single one of their parents. And what you see, and I don't want to name or any signify anybody, the government of India also came up something with something called PM Cares. State government came up with the COVID orphan scheme. So Rajkot, at that time, we had a major job to do. It was a post-COVID thing that we had to do. We went around, took the list, worked with various departments, health department, the child and nutrition department, the women and child department, the district women and child officer. Everybody worked together as a team. And I should be more than happy to say, as of today, at least in Gujarat, we are one of the districts with the highest number of payments that have been done under PM CARES. And we have taken care of all these kids even till today. We have formed a WhatsApp group with all these children's name. And the collector is like the guardian for these people who don't have parents right now. So we ensure that not only services are provided, we gave them money, the government gave them money. We also keep follow-up of their access to education, their access to rights, their access to social infrastructure, and access to whatever provisions the government as well as non-government can provide. So this is one of those satisfactory things which I personally believe that I have, or as a team, we have delivered in Rajkot. This photo says it all. You know, that was during the phase and the process when we were giving them the bank accounts. And you can see the simple number. This is just in front of my office where we keep meeting at least once in 4 months, 5 months. We have tea together. We ask, what are you going through? We ask them, what is the issue? So we just talk to one-to-one child. And you can see the situation. So now it feels so happy that I'm like the father for all these children, at least there. That gives me immense satisfaction. Once we were done with COVID, so post-COVID, what do you do? Then slowly you start thinking with yourself. You start interacting with yourself. When you go back home, you feel that you have a daughter, you have a family. What about those kids? And then slowly, when the media, the people in Rajkot also saw that some good things are happening, they came up with something to also, you have done something for COVID. Why did you take up this issue? So immediately we grabbed onto the issue. This was regarding abandoned children. Just to throw some statistics, you can see there's about 29.6 million abandoned, stranded, and orphaned children in India. Mind-boggling figures. Can you imagine? The sad part, less than 2% of those, they go to the childcare institutions. Childcare institutions are where they are taken care, they are being groomed, and imagine what about the others? They're just out there. And less than 3,000 get adopted annually. That is based on CARA's information. So what we did, and the reason, it could be both either poverty or it could be the simple reason which obviously all of you must be able to appreciate, gender bias. So what we did, we went to the PDU Medical College, got the small cabin kind of thing done there. We publicized in the local media. We did do a press conference and told, as usual, how to break into the barriers of society. We told, we have got this provision. Somebody doesn't want to, sorry to say those used words, but don't want to put your child outside. Just keep them here and go. This is what we did at the civil hospital. And you'll be surprised to know that after which we've got 16 children as of now who can range from 2 months to 6 months to 5 months, 4 months, all those days, even a year and a two. People have abandoned the kid. It could be a girl child, it could be a male child, but the statistics say it's 90% girl child. So a very sad state. But then yes, we need to do something about it. And it is the responsibility of the welfare state to take this up. What we did, this is what happened. You can see I've just masked those faces because we didn't want to show the parents or we didn't want to show the child who was later. We got people to adopt those children. And these are the parents who came forward, adopted these children. These are pictures where, the children were adopted by people from within Gujarat and outside Gujarat. And happy to say two of our children are now in Italy and Spain. So that is the kind of impact people get to make, the impact the state gets to make once you take it up in your own stride. Okay, once you are done with abandoned children, then the scope was to go about again with, you know, the next level. While doing this, we also got to know that even amongst the abandoned children, one was a child who was deaf, because of which they had abandoned. So when we took to the next level, I asked the ENT department, what can we do about this? So some statistics are there that globally there are about 63 million significant auditory impairment. In India, it's about 6.3% of the entire population who have a significant auditory impairment. That's about 293, approximately per 1 lakh population. And these children also have severe and profound hearing loss. So I told, whatever statistics you have, call those parents who, we made it in a public announcement. We announced in the district, whichever parent feel that your child is suffering from such kind of things, you please bring them to us. And then this is what happened. This is a picture of one of those meetings where we got to get the parents, we got to interact with the child. Those children could not hear. And surprisingly, we had a tie-up with an NGO also, wherein the cochlear implant was a solution. We got all the children tested. We got cochlear implants at the cost of, say, about 14 lakh rupees per implant. It's very expensive. But after doing all this and going through this, this is what you achieve. You can see this. Each child was given a 14 lakh worth equipment. Now these children can hear and they are speaking. What more do you need in life? This is where you feel that you can make an impact. And literally, the tears from the eyes of parents is worth, you know, a million smiles. This is what we did for next. What we did was we thought we are doing something for the society. And this is one where the social ostracization happens. And most of it, we started with the Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao Andolan. And after that, slowly, slowly went to those kids who were infected and the people who were infected with HIV. We called a meeting. We did a function. This is the collector office campus. We had an interaction in the evening at about 7 o'clock in the evening. There were about 500 plus people who were all infected with HIV. We interacted with them. We interacted twice, thrice, four times, asked what is their problem, what are the issues coming up, whether you're getting the medicines properly, ART medicines. We got the entire list, worked up with Gandhinagar, worked up with Delhi, NACO and everybody. Finally, we could able to provide them medicines which was not in full supply. And now I can happily say that Rajkot is one of those districts which gets a constant supply of medicines for these people, including sometimes of replacement of blood groups. And this is what we did. We got all the kids registered, had an interaction with them, asked them to go to school, convinced the teachers, convinced the schools, and these kids are going to school. They are not left out again. I think they also have a future, and they have a right to have justice who are already neglected. So this is how we were trying to bring them to the mainstream. One important topic close to probably most of you, I'm sure all the ladies would able to be appreciate this. Some statistics, if you see, are stunning. Globally, one in every three women are subject to physical violence, probably at home, probably outside, probably at workplace, probably somewhere else during their travel, probably during their interaction, any kind of things. I'm sure the teenagers would be able to appreciate later in life. There are about 31,000 complaints of crimes committed against women in 2022. This is reported, and 90% doesn't get reported, right? So these are all reports, incidents of abductions, kidnappings, rapes, killing of women, which goes unnoticed. It accounts for about 17.6% of the complaints of above. And what the fatal outcome is, something called homicide and suicide. This is the ultimate thing that happens with a woman. During this process, we also realized that, you know, this is all for the people who are normal, who can be, who are abled. What about those people who are differently abled? Somebody might use a word disability, but I would prefer to use differently abled. These are totally kept out of the mainstream. You can see that globally there are about 15% of PWDs with about 40% disability. 70% of them are unemployed. What do you do? They don't have access to food, they don't have access to education or mainstream work. So it's a moral obligation, right? Is it not? It's a social obligation to us, and it's also a medical obligation to correct it, because they're not having equal opportunities. So what we do, we provide them legal guardianship certificate to the people who can handle them. Rajkot, as of now, is one of those districts with the highest number of legal guardianship certificates, close to 400 plus, where the government schemes are being offered to these people on a daily basis. And every month we have a meeting to follow with them, like who has been getting it and who has been not getting it. And we've been conducting disability camps and giving certificates to them, schemes to them. The smile on their faces once they get the certificate from you, you cannot forget when you go home at least 4 or 5 days after you do this. It's just sheer pleasure. They don't know what's happening with them, but they smile at you, thinking that something new is happening with me and something, a ray of hope is coming to their lives. And yes, we see that those rays are working these days, and they're receiving those rays continuously. That's what we try to ensure. I think this is also one thing which we need to work on, wherein we felt that people who, what about the disabled people, differently abled people, we covered that, right? So what about those people with some other diseases also? This is where one of these hospitals tied up with us. They told we will do free checkup camps. They flew down from Chennai and Calicut and all. They tied up with the Civil Medical College here. We went on with this. And then later on, we conducted camps continuously for them. And later on, what we realized that about 130 parents, they registered on a single day. So we had to do multiple sessions of these, you know, and treat these patients. And continuously, this has been happening till date. That's what we've been finding. The sheer pleasure of giving back to society is what a social entrepreneur can think of. By doing all this, I personally feel being a social entrepreneur justifies for myself. So an entrepreneur could be a businessman wanting to make money for one's own or maybe progress, but this gives immense satisfaction. And I think we all should take it up as an opportunity if God gives you this opportunity. And this is what I think. I believe that this is your karma. You don't understand it right now, right? But you will understand later. Thank you for this opportunity.